My name is Joseph Renade. But to the villagers of Carvelin, I am always Monsieur le Maire. The Renade family have lived at Carvelin going on for 300 years. And our house, Fox's Tower, is one of the landmarks of the neighborhood. It stands in a wood which overlooks the River Brindel, almost a little fortress. And from the tower itself, the whole countryside stretches away like an enormous estate, though actually my family owns no more than a couple of hundred acres. I was standing on the terrace one morning a few months ago when my housekeeper came up to me, obviously very distressed.
Oh, excuse me, monsieur.
And what is it, Marie? Is something wrong?
It's Médéric, monsieur. He'd like a word with you.
Médéric the postman? All right, Médéric. What's the matter? You look upset.
I'm sorry, Monsieur le Maire. Down there in the wood by the bridge, I was on my rounds, coming up to the tower, and I came upon it suddenly.
Came upon what?
It was a body, Monsieur le Maire. It was lying there under the trees.
A body? Whose body, man?
I don't know, monsieur. It was lying there on the moss in the bushes. First, I found a needle case, then a thimble, and then a penknife. They were glittering in the sun, just as though they'd been dropped by someone. I picked them up, and I thought, someone has lost these. I'll give them to Monsieur le Maire. So I went on, keeping my eyes open for anything else. And then suddenly I came upon it. The feet were just in sight from the path.
What a body, you say.
It looked like a young girl, monsieur, only partly dressed. It was lying there by the bushes on the moss with a handkerchief over its face. At first I thought, she's asleep. Then I thought, no, that's funny. Asleep at 8 o'clock in the morning, in the woods like that. And then I went up to look who it was. Only I couldn't see for the handkerchief over the face. So I touched her hand to wake her. Her hand was cold, cold as ice. And I thought, she's dead. And I ran up here all the way to tell you, monsieur.
You did quite right, Médéric. Only you say you don't know who it was.
No, monsieur, I didn't like to lift the handkerchief.
Oh, monsieur, perhaps it's her, little Louise. I heard this morning earlier that she was missing. Madame Roque's daughter. She hasn't been home all night. Madame Roque was very upset and told the milkman.
What, little Louise Roque? Surely not. All right, Médéric, come and show me at once. Marie, have the bailiff, the doctor, and yes, the clerk, come out to the woods immediately. Tell them I'm going down there now with Médéric. I want them to come at once, you understand? At once! I went off with the postman there and then. He led me down through the trees to a thick clump down by the riverside, not far from the bridge. It was a short cut that he took each morning with the letters down by the side of a broad stretch of river that we call the Pool. The poor man was very excited, and it took him a few minutes to find the place. When I saw it, I refused to touch anything until we'd been joined by the others. At last they arrived, and the doctor knelt down beside her. He lifted the handkerchief from the face.
Mon Dieu. Look at that.
Little Louise Roque. But what? Her face. It's all blue and swollen.
She's been strangled. You see the marks on her neck?
Strangled? But who could do such a thing? I mean, she's been murdered.
Obviously. She's been dead, oh, I don't know, maybe 12 hours or more. The body is cold.
But why? Who would want to murder her?
That is for the police to say, Monsieur le Maire. Somebody must have attacked her yesterday.
Where are the rest of her clothes? Her dress and her shoes and stockings?
Médéric, go and call the magistrate, Monsieur Putoin, and ask him to call the police at once.
Yes, Monsieur le Maire.
But who could have done such a thing? Little Louise Roque. Look, her dress must be somewhere about. Perhaps she's been bathing in the river, or was just going to bathe. A lot of people in the village do. I shouldn't really, of course, not on my land, this side of the river, but I never objected. Why should I? Princep, go and look along the riverbank. Perhaps you'll find her shoes or something. But little Louise Roque, who could have done such a ghastly thing? Why, she's almost a child. Four of us searched the bushes and the long grass down to the water's edge for the next hour, but we found nothing at all. The magistrate arrived, and we told him how the body had been found. And then three gendarmes arrived from Louis Latour. By now, the news had spread all around the neighborhood, and the villagers had gathered in a little crowd on the river bank. At last, the moment came, which I had been dreading. We were told that the girl's mother was there. We led her to the spot, and she knelt beside the body of her daughter. Madame Roque, when did you last see your daughter?
She went out for a walk yesterday afternoon, Monsieur le Maire. We had been working in the fields, and it was very hot. I went back home to make the supper, and Louise went on by herself. She promised she would be home by 7, when she never returned.
Madame Roque came to see me early this morning, Monsieur le Maire. She said that her daughter had been out all night, and I began to make inquiries for her in the village. Then we got your message, and I came up here with the doctor right away.
It happened sometime yesterday evening, I think. The girl must have been dead since about 6 o'clock yesterday.
About 6 o'clock. I was down towards Villaume, taking a look at the wood felling there. I was on the way back when you called me over, Vernet.
Yeah, that's right, Monsieur le Maire. That must have been shortly after 6. The man just finished for the night. Monsieur le Maire was coming up the lane from Villaume. I called out to him to ask him about a large beach that we've been having trouble with.
Have any strangers been seen in the district? May have been a tramp or gypsy.
I haven't heard of any. We must ask. Pansep, ask in the village if anyone has seen any strange men around here these last few days.
Half the village appears to have come out here already.
There must have been a tramp or someone. I simply can't believe that anyone in the village...
Poor old woman. She's a widow, isn't she?
Yes, her husband died a few years ago. It was just her and the girl.
Right. Who could have done such a thing? I can't understand how anyone could kill a harmless girl like that. What had she ever done?
You can't always find a motive for murder, Miss Illimer. At least, not a personal motive. Sometimes people kill in anger. Sometimes they kill in fear.
Whoever it was, I'll send him to the guillotine if it's the last thing I do. What are the police doing about it, anyway? Have they finished searching yet?
We're going through the whole wood, monsieur. Mm? Maybe the man dropped something as he ran away.
Yes. This penknife and needle case and thimble... I found them over there, about 20 yards away.
Oh, Louise, Louise. Ah, yes, they're hers.
The penknife as well, madame?
Oh, yes. She had them in her pocket. She used
perhaps
the knife
they
to cut
dropped out of
houses.
Her pocket as she ran away.
I don't think so. I don't think she was wearing her dress at the time. I'd say she was going in to bathe, or had been in to bathe and was getting dressed again. You see, her hair is uncombed, so she must have been bathing. She was getting dressed when... someone came up to her.
Yeah, perhaps she screamed, and he strangled her to keep her quiet.
Very likely.
Well, in that case, what about the penknife and the rest? Why should they have been found over there?
If they were in the pocket of her dress, and the murderer was taking her dress away with him to hide it, they may have dropped out of the pocket without his noticing them.
Why should he want to hide the dress and the shoes and the rest? Why hide those and leave the body here in the open for the first one who came this way to find?
Maybe just to mislead us. We'll find out that when we've got our hands on the man.
Monsieur le Maire.
Yes, madame, what is it? We'll do everything we can to bring him to justice, whoever he is.
Where are her shoes? Her wooden shoes?
Her wooden shoes? Her sabots? She was wearing them.
Where are they?
Well, he must have taken her sabots along with her dress to hide them.
Listen, madame, you must tell us exactly what she was wearing when you last saw her.
Oh, please, monsieur. Please give me back her little wooden shoes. I have nothing at all to remember her by. My poor little Louis.
We all know them, Monsieur le Maire. Old Jacques in the village made them for her last spring. We should know them anywhere.
Yes, monsieur. Everybody in Cavalan knows them.
All right, all right. When we find them, madame shall have them back. I promise. But what are all these people doing hanging about here? Half the village must be here. Go on, move away. Get back to the village. You're only getting in our way. Go on, all of you.
Some of them can help carry the body back to the house. You don't mind, monsieur?
No, of course not. But you mean up to the tower?
Yes.
Oh, no, really. Can't you take her down to the village? You know what it is. The servants will be terrified. You know how superstitious they are.
Yes, of course. Now, come along, all of you. Médéric, take Madame Roque back home. The rest of you come with me. I must get my report made out. You too, Monsieur le Maire, if you're free.
Of course, anything you wish, Monsieur, but I still can't believe it. Who could have done such a horrible thing? Poor little Louise. After the taking of one or two depositions, we all sat down to lunch. The magistrate, the chief of police from Louis Latour, the doctor, and myself. Needless to say, the murder of Louise Roque was the sole topic of conversation, and all manner of theories were put forward as to who could be responsible for the crime. As a matter of fact, we all ended of the same opinion. The murder must have been committed by some tramp who happened to find the girl as she was dressing after her bathe and who strangled her to stifle her cries. But the next day proved that the theory was wrong.
Ah, Joseph, the most extraordinary thing has happened.
What do you mean, about the murder?
Yes. You remember Madame Roque yesterday, how she kept harping on the fact that she wanted her daughter's shoes to remember her by the little wooden sabot?
Yes. They found them?
Yes, they've been found. Guess where?
By the riverside, floating in the river somewhere?
No, they were found this morning on Madame Roque's doorstep. When she opened the door at 6 o'clock, there they were, side by side on her step.
Is she sure they're her daughters?
Absolutely certain. Not only the old woman, they've been positively identified by some half a dozen other people, including old Jacques, who made them.
I see. Well, what do you make of that?
Isn't it obvious? They can only have been left there by someone who heard her say that she wished she had them for a memento.
Dozens of people heard her say that. Half the village was standing there listening to her.
Yes, indeed. But there was only one man who could possibly have known where they were hidden.
You mean the murderer?
Yes, the murderer. Mm. Everyone had spent the day looking for them. They must have been carried away from the scene of the crime by the man who committed it. Therefore, he was the only man who knew where they were.
Come, come, come. Someone may have found them, wherever it was that he hid them.
Then why leave them like that, anonymously? Why not come forward and say, I found the sabot, maybe the missing dress as well. They were wherever they were.
I see, yes, yes. So?
It can mean only one thing. The man who committed the murder was there yesterday when the old woman was asking for them. Therefore, he must be one of the people of this village.
Who do you suspect?
I don't suspect anyone yet. But we know that the field has been narrowed down considerably. There can only be about 50 people who could have committed the crime, and nearly all of those people must have some reasonable alibi. We've now got to find the one who hasn't.
Very well, let's go through the whole list, starting with me.
My dear Joseph, this is no time for jokes. In any case, you said yourself. You were over towards Vilm at the time, and the bailiff confirmed the fact. No, we can rule both of us out of it to start with, for I was over at Rouy-le-Tour.
But that is where the magistrate was completely wrong. He had been in Rouy-le-Tour at the time, but I had committed the murder. The search for the murderer of Louise Roque lasted nearly all summer, but the crime could be laid at nobody's door. First one of the villagers found himself under suspicion, then another. But all of them managed at last to prove their innocence, and the police could get nowhere. Whenever the evidence began to point convincingly in any direction, I managed to help the poor unfortunate man to clear himself. I had no desire that the horrible crime should ever be charged against an innocent man. But as the months passed by, gradually the hue and cry subsided. For after all, the life of a country village must go on.
Well, nobody can say that it's been a bad harvest. In fact, I can remember only one as good in the last 35 years.
It must be a good one. Even the peasants are admitting.
Yeah, well, I must say I can't complain. I've taken more bushels to the acre down towards Villon than I ever remember before.
And then timber must be fetching a very good price.
Timber? Why timber?
Oh, you needn't trouble to look so innocent. News gets around the country, you know.
You mean the timber that I'm cutting down by the river?
Of course. Oh. I heard from Duchesne at the sawmill over at Rouy-le-Tour. After all, we know how proud you are of your beeches. And those down there by the river are the finest trees on the whole estate.
Well, I suppose they are, but I haven't been offered very much for them.
Now, why are you selling them? Why strip your land and spoil a really wonderful view from the terrace?
Well, I don't deny that I have a few regrets about it. And the view always was a favorite of mine. But somehow, since the murder, I've never been able to forget what happened down there. I remember that if there had been no trees, Louise Roque would never have gone bathing there, and if she hadn't gone bathing, she would probably never have been strangled.
True enough, I suppose.
Well, ever since I realized that, I've been able to take no pleasure in them, the trees, the view, or anything. I suppose you think I'm just being foolish or sentimental or something. Anyhow, I decided to have the trees cut.
Oh, I wouldn't say you were sentimental, Joseph. Just a bit more sensitive than the rest of us, that's all.
In a way, perhaps, Monsieur Pietoin, the magistrate, was right when he described me as hypersensitive. For the last few months, I had known no peace of mind. My thoughts and dreams had been haunted by the terrible memory of that day in the woods, the evening when I had suddenly come upon her, had lost my head, and had killed her. As the fear of discovery began to lessen, a new, a far more terrible fear began to take its place. It was the fear of always seeing the girl's twisted and agonized body lying there on the ground at my feet. That was why I had decided to strip the woods in the hope of losing her ghost among the fallen leaves.
Well, Monsieur le Maire, another good day of it?
Good.
Very fine timber, all of it. Pity to cut it in some ways.
Yes, in some ways it is.
We've been having a bit of trouble with this one. Quite a giant, isn't she? He's been working on us since 7 o'clock. Well, we're nearly through with her now.
Good, I'll stay and watch you fell it.
It won't be long now, Monsieur le Maire. By the way, wasn't it somewhere around here they found that girl in the summer? What was her name? Louise.
Louise Rock. Little Louise. Yes, it was somewhere around here, as far as I remember.
A bad business. Unbelievable that anyone could do such a thing. There's a man who must have a lot on his conscience.
Yes.
He deserves to die, if ever a man did.
Look out, monsieur, she's nearly gone.
Oh, better get back a bit, monsieur. He's a big piece of timber. Come over here a few yards.
I'm all right. I want to see her fall.
Look out, she's coming down.
No.
Get back, monsieur, there. Get back.
Monsieur, come back. Come back. Oh, is he all right?
No, I was not killed. As the tree fell, a branch struck me and knocked me off my feet, but it flung me clear of the rest. I lay there stunned, gradually returning to a consciousness of the fact that I must still go on living. I had deliberately stepped into the path of the falling trunk, hoping to die in my turn where I had brought death to that poor girl. But I was not to die so easily.
Monsieur le Maire, are you all right? Are you badly hurt?
Thank you. I'm not hurt. I'm not hurt at all. I'm only a bit shaken.
Mon Dieu. I thought you were killed for a moment. You seem to move towards it as it fell.
I must have lost my balance. I was watching the tree falling and then
Let me help you back to the house. You're as pale as though you'd seen a ghost.
Am I?
Here, take my arm. As pale as a ghost.
As pale as a ghost. The ghost of a young girl who lay there dead on the moss under that very tree 5 months before. I knew that I could go on no longer. Wherever I turned, I saw her stretched out there at my feet, her face horribly blue and swollen, the sound of her last strangled cry ringing in my ears. Well, I had tried to give my life in retribution, but it was not to be. There was no such easy way out. A dozen times I'd tried to take my life, ever since I knew that I should never be able to sleep again, that the sight of that poor twisted body would haunt me until I confessed my crime at last. I'd sat there night after night with a loaded pistol on the table before me. Time after time, I'd forced my fingers to curl round the trigger and taken the barrel between my teeth. But it was no good. I lacked the courage to die. Sooner or later, I should have to confess my guilt to the world. Come in.
Can I get you anything further, monsieur?
No, thank you, Marie. That'll be all.
Have you any letters for the post in the morning, monsieur?
No, there are no letters. Good night.
Good night, monsieur.
A letter. Yes, that was it, a letter. A letter in which I could confess, could tell the whole story, or such of it as I dare tell. If I were to write my confession in a letter and post it to Putoin, the magistrate, confessing everything, telling him that it was I who had murdered her, that I had made up my mind to kill myself, that he was to burn the letter when he heard of my death and tell no one, then I should have to find the courage, for there would be no way out once the letter was posted. My dear friend, it has taken me many months to write this letter, and only a sincere remorse for what I have done could bring me to write it at all. Ever since that terrible evening, the evening when little Louise Rock died, I have been haunted by the overwhelming knowledge of my guilt, for it was I who killed her. I came upon her suddenly down there in the woods. She had been bathing in the river and was getting dressed again. I had a foolish idea to give her a fright, to creep up and catch hold of her without her knowing who it was. I crept up to her, but she turned round and saw me and screamed. I caught hold of her, but she was terrified and wouldn't stop calling for help. I utterly lost my head. My hand closed over her throat, and before I could help myself, she was dead. I was in a panic, for I suddenly saw what I had done. I laid her down on the moss and covered her face with her handkerchief, with which she had been drying her hair. Then I took her dress and little wooden shoes and buried them under some dead leaves. Then I took the shoes round to her mother's house and left them there. It was all I could do. My dear friend, when you read this, I shall be dead. If the good name of the Renardes means anything to you at all, I beg you to let my secret die with me. I can never atone for what I have done, but at least my death will prove to you that my repentance is sincere. Try to forgive me in your heart. Joseph Renardet. When I'd sealed and stamped the letter, I took it down to the letterbox myself, there in the wall by the entrance gate to the drive. The moon was brilliant above the trees, and the fallen timber down by the river lay there like so many rigid and tortured ghosts. But I was afraid of ghosts no longer. In the morning, I should have killed myself. A fall from the tower that should be made to seem like an accident. And that last night, for the first time in 4 or 5 months, I slept without any fear.
Good morning, monsieur. It is 8 o'clock.
Thank you, Mary. What sort of a morning is it?
A beautiful morning, monsieur. Did you sleep any better last night?
Yes. Yes, I slept perfectly. By the way, what time does Médéric come to collect the post from the box?
9 o'clock, monsieur, on his way to the village.
Thank you. I want a word with him. I must
Shall
hurry.
Shall I have the boy fetch him up to the house, monsieur?
No, thank you. I'll walk down to the drive and wait for him. The walk will do me good, I think. Suddenly I saw quite clearly what an utter fool I had been. The death of little Louise was over and done with, forgotten, and nothing that I could do would ever bring her back to life again. Why was I making this confession when nobody in the world suspected me? Nobody in the world need ever know. I'd acted like a fool, given way to a fit of nervous exhaustion which had already passed. If I got the letter back, there would still be no harm done. I dressed and hurried down the drive to the letterbox. That Médéric was there before me. Good morning, Médéric.
Oh, good morning, Monsieur le Maire. Fine morning.
Médéric, I posted a letter last night to Monsieur Putois. I find I forgot something. Let me have it back, will you?
Oh, that's all right, Monsieur le Maire. It's in my bag somewhere. Mm. All right, Monsieur le Maire. You look strange.
No, perfectly all right. I hurried down the drive, that's all. Come along, the letter.
The letter?
Yes, the one you ought to give me back.
Addressed to Monsieur Putois, the magistrate.
Yes, man, it must be there somewhere. Give it to me.
Well, I'm not supposed to give back letters that have been posted. Once the letter's posted...
Give it to me, you fool. Open your bag at once. Here, let me look for it.
No, Monsieur le Maire. Let me go. I can't have anyone touching the letters that have been posted. It's against the regulations, as
but
you know.
But I tell you, the letter is mine. I don't want it to go. I want it back. Don't you understand? Give me that bag.
I can't do it, Monsieur le Maire. It's as much as my job's worth. Once a
letter... Give it to me, will you? Give it me!
I can't do it. Let go of that bag, monsieur.
Listen, Médéric, this is absurd. You know my writing. I'm not trying to conceal anything or take anything that doesn't concern me. If you open your bag, you find the letter there. Now, let me have it. That's a good fellow.
I'm not allowed to do it, monsieur.
Now, look, Médéric, nobody need know anything about it. He has 100 francs for you if you do as I say.
I'm not allowed to take bribes.
1,000 francs, Médéric.
No, monsieur, I'm taking that letter to the post office. If you care to come and see the
postmaster... Don't do that, Médéric. 5,000 francs I'll give you for that letter.
Not for a million francs, monsieur. I'm an honest man.
Don't give me that letter. I'll take it from you by force.
Here, monsieur le maire, I shall call for
you help. You fool! Give me the letter!
No. Help! Help! Help!
Give me...
Médéric! Are you all right, man? What on earth is the matter?
Monsieur le maire, he's gone mad. He attacked me because I wouldn't give him his letter.
Mine.
It's addressed to you.
Give it to me, please.
Give it to me. Can I do right, sir? Not to let him have it back.
Yes, Médéric. You did quite right.
My letter.
Come along, Renardé.
No, give me.
I'm afraid that I, too, know my duty.
My letter. Give me the letter. Give me back. My letter.